Hi, good morning. Today we are going to talk about Arzelà-Ascoli theorem on R. To be very precise, it's Arzelà-Ascoli theorem on closed and bounded intervals of R. There is also a similar version for compact metric spaces. That will be the subject matter for a second video which will follow this. And the proof which I'm going to indicate here is what is known as Cantor's diagonal trick. This trick is very useful in analysis, and I don't know how many of you have seen, most often the first proof which you see for the uncountability of R or the closed interval 0 or 1 is using Cantor's diagonal trick. Okay, and since because of time constraint, I don't want to get into that, but the basic reference for this lecture will be my article Arzelà-Ascoli theorem on R. You can download it from the MTTS site. I will give the reference in a minute. The second proof which I am going to give in the second video will be much more general. It will use certain modern aspects of compact metric spaces and their characterizations. And that proof can be adapted to prove various things about compact subsets in LP and L2, L1, okay, and even something to do with the Sobolev spaces. So that has wide-reaching consequences, even compact operators. Okay, so that proof also should be learned in the modern perspective. So both the proofs have their own merits. So let's get started. So, what you are going to do, see, all of you may know the Bolzano-Weierstrass theorem for sequences in R. What does it say? It says that if Xn is a bounded sequence in R, then there exists a convergence of sequence. Okay, it may converge to some real number x in R. Okay, and the remember the way to do that is the way I, as I had explained in sequences, I want to find a solution which is a real number. What I do is I approximate it by means of xn, but this original xn may not converge. But the subsequence xn k may converge. Let us say it may converge to some number. That number may be the solution I am looking out for. So this is the way you use Bolzano-Weierstrass or this kind of subsequence arguments. Anyway, so what we want to do is we are looking for its analog in the context of continuous functions on closed and bounded intervals. So let us look at AB, a closed and bounded interval in R, and I have a sequence of functions fn from AB to R. Okay, and this is given to me. So what I want to know is, I want to know when does there exist a subsequence fn k, okay, so that it is convergent. That's a question, right? Arzelà-Ascoli theorem tries to give a necessary and sufficient condition so that a sequence of continuous function on the closed and bounded interval has a convergent subsequence. Well, now we are talking about convergence of functions. Okay. And I assume that when you come to understand Arzelà-Ascoli theorem, you had already learned enough about uniform convergence of functions. Okay, otherwise this will be meaningless. You should stop and learn and then come back. Okay, right. So in the context of convergence of continuous functions, okay, these are all continuous. Okay, the correct notion of convergence we are looking for is uniform convergence. That is, you are given a sequence of continuous functions, fn from ab to r, and I want to know whether there exists a subsequence fn k of fn so that that is uniformly convergent on ab. It's not simply convergent, it may be pointwise convergent. No, I want uniformly convergent. Is that clear? Okay, so this is the question, and as I said, Arzila Ascali gives an answer to this question very, very decisively. So let us try to learn that. Before that, let's look at small things. As I said, I expect that you already know what is meant by uniform convergence, but let me quickly recall. So I have fn, a sequence of functions from a subset x in R. This could be any set, not necessarily subset of R. Okay, non-empty set, of course. And f is also a function from x to R. When do I say fn converges? This is my notation for uniform convergence to f on, say, the set x. If for every epsilon positive, let me write it, for every epsilon positive, I can find a natural number n, so that for all k greater than or equal to n, k again a natural number, what do I want? I want for all x in x, I want modulus fn of x or fk of x minus f of x should be less than epsilon 1, 2, 3, 4. Most often your teacher would write, for every epsilon there is an n, so that for all k greater than or equal to n, mod fx minus fx is less than epsilon for all x in capital X. They will usually write at the tail, but it's a standard practice in MTTS. We write every quantifier at the beginning so that negation becomes easier. Okay, right? So this is uniform convergence. Notice that if a function fn converges uniformly to f, then fix an x in x, then fn of x will converge to f of x pointwise. This is what is called pointwise. Okay, point. So if it's uniformly convergent, it is pointwise convergent. Okay, these are all known to you. The closely associated to this is the notion of Cauchy sequence. Again, let us recall, in real numbers, you have seen if xn is a sequence in R, then you know xn is convergent. I don't want to say where to, if and only if xn is Cauchy. Okay, this is what is called Cauchy completeness. Right? So I want to know whether there is an analog of this in the context of uniform convergence. Yes, this is also a well-known theorem. Again, I expect that you had already seen. So with the same notation, notation as in one, then fn converges uniformly to f on x if and only if fn is uniformly convergent is okay. I don't want this. If and only if fn is uniformly Cauchy. Again, just to make sure to recall your thing, it's a very similar to the way we define thing. When do I say fn is uniformly Cauchy? If for every epsilon greater than 0, there exists n in n, so that for all n and m greater than or equal to n, and for all x in capital X, what do I want? Mod fnx minus fmx is less than epsilon. Again, your teacher would have said, there exists for every epsilon positive, there exists n, so that for all n and m greater than or equal to n, mod fmx minus fnx is less than epsilon for all x in capital X. Okay, then we say it's uniformly Cauchy. Okay, this is uniformly convergent. Okay, is it clear? Good. What we want to do now, we want to understand the consequences of uniform convergence. Okay, again, let's go back to real numbers. I know that if xn is a sequence in R, and if xn converges to x, then I know xn is bounded. Right? So I want to know whether there is any analog in the context of uniform convergence. Okay? Suppose fn converges to f uniformly, okay, on capital X. I want to know whether there is some notion of boundedness. Okay, let us try to understand. Okay, suppose I take, remember these are all fn's are all continuous. Okay, let me, maybe I should stick to functions on the closed and bounded interval. Let me also assume fn is continuous. Okay, fn's are all continuous. Okay, right. What I want to know, whether this is, there is any notion of boundedness. Notice that this, even though I said about convergent sequence, you also know if xn is Cauchy, then also the sequence xn is bounded, right? Now let's go back. What is the theorem here? The theorem says a sequence fn is uniformly convergent on x if and only if it's uniformly Cauchy. Therefore, I'm looking for, okay, if fn is uniformly Cauchy, okay, right, on AB, right, whether there is any notion of boundedness. Okay, let us look at, so suppose I take epsilon equal to 1, again by uniform Cauchy, then there exists a capital N, so that for all N and M, etc., etc., right. Now let me fix M equal to capital N, therefore what do I know? I know that for every N greater than or equal to capital N, modulus Fn of X minus Fn of X is less than 1, and this is true for all X in AB. Is that okay? That means Fn of X, okay, is less than or equal to 1 plus modulus Fn of X. This is true for all X in AB and for all N greater than or equal to N. Right? Okay. But notice that my Fn is bounded on AB because Fn is continuous function on the closed and bounded interval. Therefore, it's bounded. So let Mn be the bound. Supremum of mod Fn. Right? Therefore, this is less than or equal to 1 by N. Notice that, that means, therefore, for all N greater than or equal to N, supremum of mod Fn of X, okay, as X varies on AB, this is less than or equal to 1 plus Mn, M capital N, sorry. Do you understand this? Right? Now the proof. But remember, I was only shown. Therefore, what I have shown now, all these functions happen for n greater than or equal to capital N are bounded by the same constant, namely 1 plus M capital N. Is it okay? But I am leaving with F1, mod F1 and mod Fn minus 1. The way we did here, a Cauchy sequence is bounded. The same trick. What do we do? Let mk equal to supremum of mod fk of x, okay, as x varies over k. For which k? For 1k less than or equal to n minus 1. You understand this? And again, for the same reason, fk's are continuous on the closed and bounded interval. Therefore, the supremum mk exists, right? Therefore, now let m equal to supremum of M1 to Mn minus 1 and 1 plus Mn. Right? So what do we have? We have shown that for each N in N, supremum of mod F of X as X varies over AB is bounded by M. That is, by each k, each n. See, I know that each fn is bounded by mn, but what I say, I have a uniform bound for all the n. That's why you call this, that is we have shown that this is Fn is uniformly bounded. This is a word. What does uniformly bounded mean? That means for every, there is a single constant m, and such that for every n in n and for every x in the interval a b, mod fn of x is less than equal to m. So is that clear? Okay. Notice that the proof actually shows something. I don't have to say this continuous function on interval. If fn are bounded function on a set x, and if it is uniformly Cauchy on x, that proof still follows. Because what all I needed is fn is bounded. And so, yeah, all the fn's are bounded. So the proof will go through. Are you following? Just to make sure that you are understanding the proof, let us go through that. X be any set. Okay, assume fn from x to r are bounded functions now. And assume fn is uniformly Cauchy on x, then fn is uniformly bounded. This is exactly the same proof, but it will be nice if you can go through this proof. So let us pause. You should pause, review, and then proceed. Right. I hope you have reviewed it. Now let's go to the next observation. Now let me stick to continuous functions on the interval fn ab, okay, to r. All right. Let me assume fn are uniformly convergent. Right? Assume fn uniformly convergent. Okay. Notice that if fn uniformly converges, the limit function will be again continuous. This is again well-known fact. So convergent to F, where F is from AB to R continuous. Alright. So how did you prove? Let's go through this proof. Let us try to understand we can do anything better than that. Yeah. Notice that these Fn's are continuous function of closed and bounded interval. Therefore, they are uniformly continuous. Okay. Continuity implies uniformly continuous, right? And the limit function will also be uniformly continuous, right? You understand that? So I want to exploit this fact. So let us look at fn of x minus fn of y, where x and y are in the interval ab. And this is for any n. At present, I have no issues about n. I don't have no issues about x, y. I just want to understand the uniform continuity of fn. Just from the fact I know that it's uniformly continuous, it is uniformly convergent to a function f, right? So I'm trying to recreate the proof, but on the way, we will observe something very interesting. Okay. So since fn converges uniformly, okay, to f, fn fx converges to point-wise to fx. We observed it earlier. Therefore, let's rewrite this. Therefore, fn of x minus f of x plus f of x minus f of y plus f of y minus fn of y. Do you see something very interesting happen? Yeah? What happens is, since f is uniformly continuous, I know there is a delta positive, so that whenever x and y mod x minus y is less than delta, mod fx minus fy is less than epsilon. But since I want to show this is less than epsilon, let me say this is epsilon by 3. Okay, I'm not writing. I hope you follow me. I'm using uniform continuity of f to that. Right? Now let's look at fn of x. Fn converges to f uniformly. Therefore, if you give me epsilon, there exists an n, so that if n is greater than or equal to capital N, no matter what x you took, this will be less than epsilon by 3. For the same reason. Now that's where I use uniform convergence. Right? Now y could be any other point, but the same n will work and the same for any n greater than or equal to capital N, this will also be less than epsilon by 3. Therefore, I have shown this is less than epsilon. Okay, that is for all n greater than or equal to capital N and for all xy in AB, so that mod x minus y is less than delta implies f1 of x minus f1 of y is less than epsilon. Okay, did I go through fast? Please quickly go through it. Okay, if you want, do a small PRP. I'm just repeating the proof. But what is interesting is something, okay, I know f1s are uniformly continuous. So for a given epsilon positive, I know there is a delta n, okay, which corresponds to the uniform continuity of fn. But notice that if the moment n is greater than or equal to capital N, what I have got is the single delta is going to work for all the n. Of course, n should be greater than or equal to capital N. Do you understand this? So what you have shown is this. Okay, this is clear, but what we have found is we have found there exists a delta positive so that for all x, y in AB with mod x minus y is less than delta and for all n greater than or equal to capital N, we have fn of x minus fn of y is less than epsilon. So the delta n which depended on n, now we are replaced by one single delta. For how many? I have one up to capital N minus one. I do not know this. After this, for all these things, a single delta is going to work. Right? Now you can ask the next question. Can I find a single delta for all n with no restrictions of this, no restrictions of this kind? Of course, that's very easy. It's a standard trick now, right? I'm sure all of you can guess. For each k, 1 less than or equal to k less than or equal to n minus 1, this is uniformly continuous. Therefore, there is a delta k for this corresponding epsilon, right? Therefore, what do? I took now, this is my delta n. Maybe you know, make it delta n. Okay. So, there is delta to be minimum of delta 1, delta 2, and delta n. And which should also be, of course, this is positive, and this will be less than that. Do you see that? Then what happens? This, for this delta, for any x and y in AB, with mod x minus y less than delta, I have mod fnx minus fny is less than epsilon. Is that clear? If my n is between 1 and capital N minus 1, okay, this delta will be less than corresponding delta n. Therefore, that is correct. And if n is greater than or equal to capital N, okay, this delta is minimum of delta N. Therefore, that's also going to work. All of you understand? Yeah? Please pause, review, and proceed. So, this introduces a notion of equicontinuity now, right? What have we shown now? We have shown that, okay, if fn converges to f uniformly, okay, on AB, remember fn's are all continuous functions, they are uniformly continuous already. If fn converges to f uniformly on AB, then what we showed was there exists a single delta positive so that, okay, uniform continuity for a given epsilon, there is a single delta, so that for all n, that is for all fn, the same delta will work. Okay, so let us make a definition. I have f, a family of continuous function. I don't know to say they are family of continuous function. You will see the reason why, family of functions, f from AB to R. Okay, I say this family is uniformly equicontinuous. on AB, what should happen? It should be, for you give me an epsilon positive, okay, I want to say there is a single delta positive, so that for all x, y in the interval AB, so that mod x minus y is less than delta, and for every f, this is the important thing, for every f in f, what should happen? Mod fx minus fy is less than epsilon. Notice that this definition says that any function f in the family, okay, is uniformly continuous. Why? You give an epsilon, right? You give an epsilon, then there is a delta for every x and y with mod x minus y less than delta, f mod fx minus fy is less than epsilon. That means every f is uniformly continuous. You understand that? As a consequence, first observation is every f in script f is uniformly continuous. Do you understand this? Right? Very good. So, what do I know therefore is f is a family of uniformly continuous function on AB. But the interesting thing is, if you give an epsilon positive, because f is uniformly continuous, this function f is uniformly continuous, there exists an epsilon. This epsilon will depend upon, there is a delta. The delta will depend upon epsilon as well as the function f. Right? If f is uniformly continuous, what does it mean? For any given epsilon, there is a delta. So that delta depends on epsilon as well as the function. Okay? So that something happens. Mod x minus y less than delta implies blah, blah, blah. Right? Okay? But if it is uniformly continuous, what we want is this. There exists a single delta which is going to work for every function in that family. Now, please spend some time. Make sure you understand this. Just to make sure you understand, let me ask you a question. Suppose I delete this. I want to define only a family of functions. C-set is uniformly, is equicontinuous on AB. How will I define? That means it should be continuous at each and every point. That means you will say for every epsilon positive, for every x in AB, there is a delta. That delta will depend upon epsilon and x now, so that whenever mod x minus y is less than delta, and for every f, mod fx minus fy is less than epsilon. Okay, I deliberately went little fast, tried to think, tried to see whether you can get hold of what should be the definition of equicontinuous family. Then, okay, each function will be continuous at each and every x. Therefore, you give an epsilon and the point x, then there is a delta, x. That delta will depend upon f as well as x. Now, what I am saying? For that delta x will not depend on f. It will depend only on x. Okay? Okay, that's good enough. I don't want to confuse you any further. Let us stop there. Okay. Once you are given the definition of uniform equicontinuous, let us look at some examples. Okay? Right. The first example is, suppose I have AB and suppose I have a continuous function. Then we know it is uniformly continuous. Right? Now my script F, the family consists of only singleton F. Is it then this is uniformly equicontinuous. You understand this? Equicontinuous family. There is nothing to check by very definition, right? But this should suggest how to generalize this immediately. How many of you can think of it? This observation, you can generalize very obvious in a very natural way. Yes? How many of you got it? Suppose FK from AB to R are continuous, then they are of course uniformly continuous. And how many are there? There are only some m number of such functions. Now let's look at the family F to be this a finite family. Then I claim this is uniformly equicontinuous. How many of you agree? Very obvious, right? Because if you give an epsilon positive, for each k, there is a delta k, which corresponds to uniform continuity of fk. You understand? Therefore, what all I have to do is I have to take delta to be, yes, you got it right. Okay, so there is no charm. So the real charm with the family of equicontinuous functions arises only if the family is infinite. It's a finite, there is no problem, right? Just you have to only collect a finite number of uniformly continuous functions that will be uniformly equicontinuous. Okay. Now the third example, this is the most important. Okay. Those of you who have seen my book, okay, will know one of the important ways to construct uniformly continuous functions of a good family of a class of examples is the following. Suppose I have a function, let us say AB, it need not be closed and bound interval, any interval for that matter. J is an interval in R. Interval I know I need for obvious reasons. Okay. Suppose this is differentiable and said that f dash is bounded. What does it mean? There is an m positive, so that for all x in j, mod f dash x is less than equal to m. Then f is actually Lipschitz and hence uniformly continuous. Why? If you don't know the word Lipschitz, do not worry. I am going to say, okay, take any x and y in J. Remember, this is an interval, right? Therefore, the entire interval x, y will be contained in J. Okay, since J is an interval. Okay, now you said f is differentiable on capital J, therefore f is going to be continuous on J, and hence f is going to be continuous on the closed and bounded interval AB. You understand that? Now I can use mean value theorem. What does mean value theorem says? It says fx minus fy equal to some f dash of z into x minus y, where z lies in the interval xy or yx. I'm sorry, I said yxy. It may be yx also, depending upon which is bigger, which is smaller. So it's z is a point between x and y. You understand this? Now I want to estimate this. Mod fx minus fy is less than or equal to mod f dash z, but remember f dash z is less than or equal to m, therefore m into mod x minus y. So this is what is known as Lipschitz function. Fx minus fy is less than or equal to some constant L times distance between x and y, that is called Lipschitz function. Now this is uniformly continuous. Why? I want this to be less than epsilon, therefore it's enough if I make this to be less than epsilon. That means I have to choose mod x minus y should be less than epsilon by m, therefore I will choose my delta to be any positive number which is less than this. That's it. You understood that? Okay. Now, so what I have done now, I have told you an important how to get an important class of uniformly continuous function. Why would I do it here? That is to make sure that now you know what is the next question and you should be able to answer. What is the next question? Is there an analog construction in the context of equicontinuity? Yeah, answer is obvious. How many of you can get the answer? So let F be a family of functions from a closed and bounded interval AB to R, such that these are all differentiable. Each F is differentiable And there is a single constant m such that for all x in AB and for all f in script f, I have f dash of x is less than or equal to m. Then this family f is uniformly equicontinuous. Okay, just I leave it as in a trivial exercise. Pause the video, review, and then proceed. For example, this is the one which you will need in the context of differential equations. Okay. Now we are ready to prove, state the Arzelà-Ascoli theorem. Okay, I don't know whether I will have time because I want to restrict this to be less than 1 hour. If necessary, I will continue in the second lecture. This will be Arzelà-Ascoli on R1. Then there could be Arzelà-Ascoli on R2. Let us see that. So what does the theorem says is the following theorem, Arzelà-Ascoli. Now we are ready to state and prove. So let F be a family of continuous functions on a closed and bounded interval AB on R. Okay, assume one, f is uniformly bounded. What is uniformly bounded? There is a single m, so that for all x in AB and for any function f in the family f, mod fx should be less than or equal to m. We had already seen the definition. And we know if f1 converges to f uniformly, then we know the sequence f1 is uniformly bounded. See, that is why it's a necessary condition. And what is the second condition? The family is uniformly equicontinuous on AB. Okay. Now, what is the conclusion? Then, okay. Maybe if you want, let us assume this family to be a sequence. Then, okay, there is a convergence of sequence. So let us assume my f to be a sequence fn. Okay, then these fn's are uniformly bounded and this family fn as n varies over n. Okay, this is uniformly equicontinuous. Okay, then there exists a subsequence fnk of fn so that fn converges uniformly on AB. fnk converges uniformly on AB. On AB. Okay. So just a slightly change. It's the same thing. Once you give me a family, I can always, if it's a finite family, there is nothing to prove. Otherwise, you extract a sequence out of that. Since f is uniformly bounded, the sequence f1 will also be uniformly bounded. You understand? So there is no loss of generality. I am assuming the family to be a sequence. Is that okay? Right. So before we go further, I would like to deal with the subsequences. If you had already seen my lectures on sequences, and I had explained how the subsequences arise. Remember, when you say x is a sequence, then in x, a set x, then it's a function. Okay. Then we denote it by ordered n to infinite tuple x1, x2, xn. And where n is the nth term. Right. Now, when I say a subsequent, my way of defining will be there is an infinite subset of n and restrict x to s. Then I call this function x restriction to s to x as a subsequent. Do not get very much worried, it's very easy. Remember, S is an infinite set, therefore, by well ordering principle, there is a least element n1. Throw n1 out of x, then still the set is infinite, therefore, there exists a least element, call it n2, that will be greater than n1. So, this way, I produce an increasing sequence. Okay? Therefore, yes, I can actually exhibit this for a proof. See my book on real analysis. Basic course in real analysis. Okay. So, a subsequence, yeah, means if there is a subset S. Okay. Right. Therefore, what does this mean? There exists an infinite subset S of n, so that Fnk, where nk lies in the subset S, okay, that is a sequence, that sequence converges uniformly. Is that all right? Okay. Now, what do I want to do? I want to prove this. The trick is very easy. Okay, this is where the Cantor's diagonal tricks come. Okay, what does this say? It says the following. Let us look at AB. And look at the subset of rational numbers in AB. All of you know this is countable. So again, it records, as you can see, our countability notion. It's a countable set. And countably infinite. Okay, it's also infinite set. Therefore, I can write this. There is a bijection of n onto this set. Right? So that means I can enumerate these elements as I can write them as a sequence Rn. Okay. There is no order. There is a sequence Rn except R1, R2, Rn. That's the only order. The order depends on the suffix, not between Rn and Rm. Okay. So I can enumerate all these elements. This set is written as a sequence Rn. Do you understand this? Okay. Cantor's trick, diagonal trick, is the following. What he says, let us look at the Fn. This is uniformly bounded sequence, right? Therefore, there is a name such that mod Fn of x is less than or equal to m for every x in AB. Right? In particular, let us look at fix a k in n. Look at the some rational number here, AB intersection Q. Let us look at Fn of R. This is a bounded sequence of real numbers. Maybe let us call it R1. Okay. Okay, this we have written as a sequence Rn. Look at R1. Let us look at Fn of R1. This is a sequence of real numbers. And it is bounded by M. Therefore, by Boltzmann and Weierstrass theorem, I know there is a convergent subsequence of these numbers. You understand that? Therefore, there exists by Boltzmann and Weierstrass, there is this a subsequence F and K, so that F and K of R1 is convergent. Right? That is the same as saying there is a subset, call it S1 in N, which is an infinite set. Okay, all these elements are n1 less than n2 less than nk. Therefore, my S1, I may be able to write n1 less than n2, etc. But what we plan to do is a slightly different way. I want to write it as something like, say, k11 less than k12 less than k1n less than k1. Okay, k1n. 3, let us say k1n less than k1n plus 1 and so on. this increase in sequence. My n1 is k11. Why I want to do is I want to construct an s2 also, which is an inference subset of s1. Do you understand this? Make sure that you follow that carefully. The same n1 is what I am calling k11. Therefore the corresponding function, I should say that fk12, that is fkn. Okay, this is k is 1. Sorry, fkn. You understand this? K1n is the nth term of the sequence, so I would write it. You see that how clumsy it looks? So in textbooks, you might have seen they will usually denote by f1n. So this k also they suppress. Is that clear? This is one source of confusion for students. Right? You understood that? I don't want this k. I just write simply 1n. That okay, this is what means. This means, look at the infinite set S1, it's the nth smallest number. This is my nk. See, this n1 is the first smallest number, n2 is the second smallest number, n3 is the third smallest number, nk is the kth smallest number. Therefore, this stands for nth smallest number in S1. Right? This 1n stands for the nth smallest number in S1. Do you understand that? Okay, now what is the reason why we took so much time for this? That's because, now let's look at, so I have found a subsequence f1n. If you want, I can denote by fkk in S1. Yeah, so that fk at R1 is convergent. Right, as k varies in S1. Do you understand? This subsequence is convergent. Now what I want to do is, I want to find another subsequence which will converge not only at R1, it also converges R2. How will I do that? Now let's look at fn1 R2. Now this is a sequence of real numbers. This is same as fk of R2 as k varies on S1. Do you understand this? Okay, don't get confused. Okay, if you're happy with this, stick to that, no problem. You understood this? Now this is again for the same reason. This is a bounded sequence of real numbers, therefore I know there is this subsequence of these real numbers which is convergent. Okay, this is a bounded sequence. Remember, f1n r1 is convergent, but f1n r2 is only bounded. So I want to extract a subsequence, right? So what does that mean? That means there is an infinite subset S2 of S1, so that fk of R2, where now k is allowed only to run over S2. This is convergent. Remember, S2 is a subset of k, therefore fk is fk of R1. Okay, this is a subsequence of, as k varies over S2, is a subsequence of fk of R1 as k varies over S1. Since this is convergent, this will also be convergent. But as k varies over S2, by our choice of S2, fk of R2 is convergent. That means, for as k varies over S2, fk of R1 is convergent, fk of R2 is also convergent. Now, how will I denote it? The classical books, how will I denote this notation? So this second subsequence I will denote by f2n. That is s2, the first element is 21, k21, second element is k22, nth element is k2n. This is my sequence. This is just a notation. Do not get frightened. Okay, so I have a sequence f2n, which is a subsequence of, I will just write this, this is just a subsequence of f1n, but this is a subsequence of fn, right? What do I know about this subsequence? This converges for R1. This sequence I chose so that it converges R2, but this being a subsequence of this, this converges for R1 as well as R2. Do you understand this? Right? Good. So, it's a good time to pause, review, and then we will proceed. Okay, please go through it. Only the notation may be difficult. Otherwise, there is nothing wrong. Revise it. Come back. We will continue the proof. Yeah. Let me assure you, it just takes another 2 or 3 minutes. I have heard from your part. You will follow it. Okay. Let us stop here. We will meet again.